Arise, take up your mat, and go home. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Two things that I'd like us to consider today in this gospel. Our home, it's the beginning and the end of this gospel. Our Lord is referred to as being at home at the beginning. And at the end, of course, the paralytic is told to take his pallet, to take his cot, and to go to his home. But the second thing for us to consider is the paralysis. And of course, as the Lord, as the church has placed before us, we consider these miracles not just simply as miracles, but as healings, again, not just as acts of compassion of our Lord, but because they symbolize spiritual maladies. And immediately before this episode of the paralytic, we have the episode of the leper, which was on the second Sunday of Lent. And so it's after healing this man of his leprosy that our Lord returns to Capernaum. And it's there that he is found at home. And that's why the people begin to crowd, because they've heard more and more of these stories. And of course, the paralytic, again, for us, will also symbolize the problem of sin. In this case, of the fact that it paralyzes. Our Lord in the Gospel says, that by which we sin, we are servants too. We become slaves of the things that we serve in our sin. The sin becomes our master. And as I mentioned before, if you haven't done so, read the Confessions of St. Augustine. This work of St. Augustine is not just about someone who lived in the 4th century, but it's a psychological analysis of how he got to the predicament of his life by the age of 30 that he was in. He's writing it, of course, in his 50s, but he's reflecting over the whole course of his events through his teenage years, through his 20s, and how he wound up paralyzing himself, quite literally, through sin. He had come to the point, as an example, where he thought that it was physically impossible to be chaste. But what he does in this analysis of every man is he talks about the pleasures which enticed him to make certain choices. And these choices, his sins, in being chosen, being chosen regularly, became habits. And the habits, he said, became necessity. And necessity became chains. So he talks about how he had imprisoned himself as he analyzes throughout these books of his confessions, the choices that he made according to the things of this world, sexual sins, the vanity and the arrogance of what he chose for affluence and good jobs. Because even as he analyzes the sins that he went through in his 20s and his 30s, his teens and his 20s, on the level of the world, he was doing wonderfully well. He had a great job, he worked, he had an imperial job. And so when he analyzes it, he's talking about this paralysis which sets in. We have another example that we have that surrounds us across the nation now. We talk about an opioid epidemic, but it's not an epidemic. Epidemic is germs, bacteria, viruses, things you catch. The addiction problem is much more profound because it is a problem which is in the human psyche, in our emotions, in our choices, in our will. And as St. Augustine says, there are things that we begin which cause a whole series of events from what begins as pleasures and sins, of habits, of necessity, and then chains. And the reason why I bring up this epidemic or this opioid addiction crisis that we're having nationally is because for those families who have dealt with addicts, you know what that slavery entails. The lying, the manipulation, stealing. Things that will be done to serve that necessity. It's a form of paralysis which stops us in our tracks. It stops us from living our properly human life. And so the paralytic today is an example example of what sin does to us by bringing us full stop in paralysis. That's what he symbolizes. But of course, he and his friends are an example of tremendous devotion and faith to this rabbi of Nazareth. And when we look at the story, what's happening, of course, is that our Lord has all these people coming to him in Capernaum. Because of the miracles, because of the teachings, and again, notice what's central here is the teaching. They come to see him while he's at home, and he preaches to them the word. He's giving them the gospel, he's teaching them, he's enlightening their minds. And we're told that there are people everywhere. So you have to picture to yourself this Middle Eastern town with little alleyways up and down all around, and that the roofs of these houses are flat. We have flat roofs here. We have problems with them in the north, of course, because it doesn't make any sense to build a flat roof because they always leak. But if you live in the southwest or if you live in the Middle East, you make them flat because it doesn't matter. There's not that much rain and there's certainly no snow. And plus, the roofs are flat because in the summertime, when it's extraordinarily hot, you'd sleep on the roof of your house. It's too hot inside to sleep. And so oftentimes on the outside of these houses, there would be stairs going up to the roof area, outside, so that you could get to the roof of the house. And so in these little tight, narrow ways, and our Lord being at home, which is certainly the home of Simon Peter, everyone's jammed in there. We're told they can't even stand in the doorway. So they're in the room, they're filling the house, they fill the roadway outside, the alleyway outside, and in the midst of this crowd comes this group of men carrying their friend who's paralyzed. They can't get in through the crowds, they can't get to the house, they try to push themselves through carrying this cot. And as they work their way through, they can't get to the house. And so in their frustration, they start pushing around through the crowd, and they go up through the side on the stairs. They go up to the top of the house. Now, clearly, they already went to the staircase knowing what they're going to do. So that when they get to the top of the house, they start pounding away at this flat roof, knocking all the adobe and the matting and the straw that would have been used for the roofing, to start busting a hole through to let a full-grown man, go down in it. And you're not going down feet forward, and the poor man would just collapse inside. So they're smashing an enormous hole to try to bring this cot down so they can lower him down through this. So you have to picture, certainly Simon Peter, as he's inside his house, it's already bad enough that it's completely overrun by people. But all of a sudden, there's plaster falling down because someone's pounding a hole through your roof. As this plaster comes down in pieces of straw, all of a sudden you realize that they're letting someone down physically through this hole. It's quite an extraordinary scene. A bit insane, but again, it's this devotion. Is we are going to see this rabbi no matter what. And so they do. And down comes this man being lowered down by his four friends, who are clearly still up in the hole of the roof. They don't come down. They just lower their buddy down. And we're told our Lord is impressed by this devotion. He's impressed by this faith. It's pretty audacious. And he looks at this man in front of him and he says, "Son, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven you." Which you can picture the kind of confused look at the men's faces up in the hole. Because, well, that's not really what we came for. We want him to walk again. So they're a bit befuddled. And at the same time, the scribes, the educated men who are around our Lord, they're angry. They're saying, "This is absurd. Who can forgive sins except God? This man's blaspheming. He blasphemes." And our Lord knows what's going on in their hearts the same way he knows what's going on in the heart of this gentleman in front of him, the paralytic. He knows that what is more important for this paralytic is that his sins be forgiven. You can be crippled and be a saint. But you cannot be a sinner and save your soul. The more serious aspect of this man is that his sins be forgiven. But the problem of the scribes that our Lord analyzes and then winds up bringing out into the open by asking them, why are you thinking these things? Which is easier for me to say? Your sins are forgiven you? Or to say to the paralytic, arise, take up your pallet and walk? Which one's easier? They're just words. What our Lord is doing is transferring the forgiveness of sins from the sacrifices of the temple. And in doing so, what he's doing is he's transferring it to his person, the Son of Man. We've talked about this term, Son of Man, to the common people jammed around in this alleyway and in the house. Bar Adom just means the son of someone, means a man, some guy, we would say today in modern English. And some guy doesn't strike them as being any kind of great importance. But what you can look up this week, along with this gospel, is look up the prophecy of Daniel in chapter 7. Because when our Lord uses the term the Son of Man, specifically in this religious context, the scribes understand exactly what our Lord is talking about, which is why they shut up. They don't say anything after this. But what our Lord is claiming to Daniel chapter 7, verse 13, Daniel has a vision in the middle of the night. Daniel's in captivity. This is about 500 or so years before our Lord. And Daniel has a vision in which he sees one like the Son of Man being carried on the clouds to the Ancient of Days, God, who confers upon him kingdom and power and majesty, and that all the peoples of the earth, all the nations and all the tongues of the earth shall serve him. This power and this sovereignty that belongs to the Son of Man. In the Hebrew, the term for the clouds is Anan, which is why in the rabbinical literature of this prophecy of Daniel, which everyone accepted was messianic, they refer to the Messiah as being Anani, of the clouds. Now this is important to remember because when our Lord in a few weeks' time, during the season of Lent, when we read the Passion, and he's in front of the priest in the Sanhedrin, and they put our Lord under oath, that you must answer this question, whether or not you are the Christ. Our Lord answers by saying, you shall see the Son of Man come upon the clouds of power. He's referring today in today's gospel and at that moment to this vision of the prophet Daniel. And it's a transfer of the forgiveness of sins from the temple to the very person of the Son of Man. That's what's happening doctrinally in this episode. And that's why after our Lord says this to them, he turns to this man hanging here. He's still hanging in front of him in the pallet. Or he's been let down, but since we're told the house is jammed full of people, he's hanging somewhere in the midst of this crowd still by the four men hanging through the window, through the hole in the ceiling. And he looks at the man and he says, after having asked this question, which is easier to say than to do, but so that you may know that sins are forgiven, that the Son of Man has the power to heal these wounds of the mind and of the spirit. He looks at the paralytic, I say to you, son, arise, take up your pallet, and go home. Which is then what he does. And taking the pallet away from the men who are hanging above him, he pushes his way through the jammed, crowded house and goes home. The story is easy to understand, but the aspect of the paralysis of sin, we don't necessarily think about. We don't think about how our lives are changed by our vices, by our habitual sin. When we use the word vice, it makes it sound like we're serial killers. The word vice just means habitual sin. Things that I go back to again and again. Things that are second nature. That's a vice. And we don't often think about how our lives are just as much formed by those bad habits as by individual sins. That's the paralysis of sin. So what I want to leave you with as we return to this notion of home. What is home? It's not just a house. We often say that home is where the heart is. And there's a lot of truth in it. There's much truth in this. It's where we love. It's where we feel secure. It's our place, whether it's huge and majestic and filled with wonderful works of art, or it's an overloaded little mobile home that's packed up like a gerbil cage, it's still mine. And I'm comfortable here. Maybe nobody else is comfortable in this place, but this is my home. This is my place where my heart is. This is what I love. Now this is important because, of course, as I said, the beginning of today's gospel talks about our Lord being at home. His place of security is at Simon Peter's house. That's his home. And when he heals this man from his sin and from his paralysis, he tells him at that point, take what's been carrying you and go home. Find your security. Find your place of rest. Return home. And ultimately, of course, Christ, in a spiritual sense, is our home. If you look again at the prayers at the beginning of today's Mass, we make this reference and refer to our Lord as the harbor of salvation. And that's really the last point. During the whole season of Lent, our purpose of these considerations and our daily prayers and our fasting and our penances are meant to be the way that we pass through this world towards our true home, which in the Syriac fathers, they use nautical terms. In our little boat, as we get bashed around by the vicissitudes of this world and by the bad choices we make, our little boat rocking, our purpose is to arrive at the harbor of salvation, to arrive at this place of security in which, we are told in our prayers, Christ is the harbor of salvation. So as I've talked to you about Lazarus Saturday, Palm Sunday I don't need to talk to you about much, we have a ceremony in our Syriac tradition in this nautical terminology called coming into the harbor. Now coming into the harbor is a ceremony that probably most people don't, they might have heard the term, but they haven't been at. They don't do the prayers. But what coming into the harbor is something which was done historically throughout the centuries on Sunday evening of Shanim, of Hosanna Sunday, Palm Sunday. Because in the Syriac tradition, every day begins with sundown the evening before. The day begins with the sun setting. So Sunday evening is the beginning of Monday. Passion Week, the great week and holy week, in which we commemorate our Lord's death and resurrection. Passion Week is an entirely different liturgical season within the Great Fast. And to signify that arrival at the end of the weeks of fast and penance, we have a ceremony on Sunday evening called Coming into the Harbor, beginning Monday as we enter into the weeks of commemoration. At that point for that week, our televisions definitely should be turned off. Noise should definitely be coming down as we focus upon those last week, that last 5 days, specifically of our Lord's presence on earth leading up to his passion. Now oftentimes, and I believe here, you've been doing Coming into the Harbor somewhere around, what was it, Tuesday at noon or something. But of course there you're already 3 days into this thing. I have greater faith in you. Now oftentimes in many parishes, they do it on Monday night or something, because they go, that people don't come back to church for a second time on Sunday. Which may be true on a practical level. But again, I think you have more stuff in you than that. The question was asked me recently, what's a Maronite? Why Maronite? The whole notion that we come in this monastic church, this monastic tradition, meant that our ancestors were always in church. That's why they came around the monasteries and the convents, was distinctly was their attachment to the prayers of the church. Not just Mass. Give Jesus 60 minutes in and out and get out of here. Or maybe an hour and a half if you've got a priest who preaches too long. But the idea that they returned for even night prayers on a daily basis in their villages, of course, they were closer, they could walk to their churches. And so I think in the recent history where we've taken and the coming into the harbor and put it on Tuesday or Wednesday or Monday or whatever, to make it easier, it no longer has its symbolism. Coming into the harbor begins the week of the Passion. So because I think you have greater strength and a greater desire to be truly Maronite, I propose to you this year that we do it correctly. And that on Sunday evening of Palm Sunday, we will do our ceremony of coming into the harbor. We don't give anything, there's no communion, there's no Mass, there's no nothing. It fulfills no obligations, it's purely an act of devotion that we do on our own. We will do the ceremony of coming into the harbor, singing that we are preparing during this great fast now to consider our Lord's Passion because we desire to come home. We desire to find that peace and that security and that rest. And then following this short ceremony, we will sing Ramshaw. Or if we don't sing very well, we'll recite Ramshaw. The evening office. Ramshaw in Syriac means evening, and it's the equivalent in the Latin Church of Vespers. And so we'll do the small ceremony, followed by Ramshaw. I have great faith in you, and your desire to become more and more profoundly Maronites. So we're going to put it back on in Sunday, and open up Holy Week in the truly correct way that the Maronites have done for centuries, by the celebration of coming into the harbor. May our Lord forgive us our sins, break the paralysis that holds us by our vices, and allow us to walk, arising, to walk, and to enter into the harbor of peace, and to find our true homes. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.